Welcome to Intuition. Let's continue discussing basic issues in atmospheric physics in relation to climate change and climate modeling. So far, I have mentioned a number of climate researchers before 1900 and after 1960, such as Tyndall, Arrhenius, and Manabe, and Hausmann. But how about those in between? Today, I'm going to introduce some interesting work by John Strong, who first used infrared spectroscopy to find water vapor in the atmosphere of Venus. I'm sure you'll be delighted to find some untold historical observations from my talk today as part of our exploration for the climate IFE. So, are you ready? I mean, like, subscribe, share, and make a comment. Okay, thank you very much. Let's go and have fun. I first knew John Strong when I saw this infrared absorption spectra of the atmosphere of the Earth. It was reported by Strong internally in 1948, but this diagram was publicly used by Brooks, another greenhouse effect believer. The shaded area represents the absorption by water vapor, CO2, and ozone measured in NAP, while the red colored curve was measured from the real atmosphere by using the sun as a radiation source. Perhaps it is necessary to explain how air absorption was measured in that. Similar to what Tyndall first used, air is pumped in a long pipe with adjustable pressures so that the ray can interact with the air molecules. The path-dependent transmission function can be derived. In order to mimic the actual atmospheric absorption, the pipe could be very long, say 30 meters or even longer, while the gas density is assumed a constant. In this way, the absorption band detected at the end can be noticeably wider than the absorption peak observed near the infrared source. For this reason, one cannot simply use the CO2 spectra at 50 micron detected by using a commercial infrared spectrometer as a reference for an observable CO2 band at the top of the atmosphere, as Dr. Hans Hock did many years ago. Still, compared with the real vertical path in the atmosphere, the path built in NAP would never be long enough. Fortunately, this doesn't matter. Why? Because the air density or the atmospheric pressure decreases exponentially with the altitude. As a result, the product of the mean absorption coefficient, air density, and the average height of the atmosphere will be finite. Therefore, by using a proper air pressure, measurement in NAP can still provide some new insights into the infrared transmission in the real atmosphere. Although it has been known CO2 absorption occurs near 15 micron or 667 wave number per centimeter, as I discussed before, further observations are still necessary because the absorption and emission signal might be interact at different altitudes, making theoretical prediction difficult or even impossible. So far, it has been generally accepted that the CO2 absorption can be clearly seen in an OIR spectra, as shown in this diagram. Besides, the CO2 emission at the center of the 15 micron band can be observed from a satellite, as shown by the single tiny upward spike here. Further, it is argued that the CO2 emission signal are emitted from the layers above the troposphere. For people who are not familiar with radiative transfer. Such claims are too abstract. But I don't think they are true. Based on my in-depth investigations, or should I say re-investigation so far. In particular, I think CO2 absorption can only be detected at the center rather than on the both wings of the central peak. As I discussed before, the transition probability of the central Q branch is a several order of magnitude higher than that on the remote Q branches. Therefore, strong self-absorption could easily occur by CO2 molecules in higher altitude from the CO2 molecules in lower altitudes. As a result, it could be argued that the so-called stratospherical cooling can be prevented even though CO2 molecules are emitting outside the center frequency at which CO2 absorption prevails. If so, the central Q spike might be upside down observed at the top of the atmosphere, although the overall emission by CO2 molecules around 15 micron could be stronger than the continuum absorption under favorable conditions, as shown here. Now, let's increase CO2 concentration. As you can see, the CO2 emission increases above the 250K Planckian curve. If you look at the CO2 emission peak carefully, you will notice the Q branch at the center is downward, meaning the net CO2 absorption occurs over there. This is what I predicted. You can call it as a speculation, which is quite different from the consensus you can often find in many OLR spectra of the Earth based on the data recorded by the IRIS infrared spectrometer on Nimbus 3 and 4. Forget about the computer simulations by many climate researchers for the time being, as I have been more concerned about whether I could find some experimental observations in support of my speculation. The good news is that I have recently found some experimental observation by John Strong and his team, which provides direct evidence for my analysis that made me laugh in my dreams. Here is the infrared emission spectra measured by Strong in 1969, 1 year before the launch of Nimbus 3. The observation range is between 350 and 1400 per centimeter. Notice the spectra is the emission of air with water vapor and CO2. Indeed, as you can see, the central Q branch in the CO2 is downward, as I explained above. However, as you can see, the satellite Q branches are upward, meaning CO2 molecules are emitting infrared at those frequencies. How could I explain this phenomenon? Fortunately, the answer has been found from an early paper by Strong and Plus, published in 1950, entitled "The Effect of the Pressure Broadening of Spectral Lines on the Atmospherical Temperature." In short, as shown in this diagram, the CO2 line width increases as the air pressure increases. Based on this effect, the authors argued that the CO2 emission from both the wings could easily reach outer space, although it seems unlikely at the center. More experimental observations in support of my explanation are shown here, including this high-resolution emission spectra from Strong's final report in 1972. The observation range is between wave number 670 to 740 per centimeter, in which both the observation in the lab and from the sky are shown in this diagram. As you can see, relatively speaking, the signal-to-noise ratio is much lower from the sky spectra compared with that measured in lab. This means that the spectra I used here might represent the upper limit of the CO2 emission that might be observed from the top of the atmosphere. In other words, the emission signal from CO2 in the atmosphere could be too weak to be detected, as I had argued before. What do you think? Do you believe the CO2 signal around 15 micron can be as strong as the ozone located inside the atmospheric window? Strong called himself a stubborn optimist. He loved making observations by building his own instrument. Nobody had done. I am a stubborn optimist too. Let's remember him. I hope you found this talk interesting. Thank you for your watching, making comments, and donation. See you next time.